Hey guys, it's Quinn, and today we're going to be taking a look at 1995's GoldenEye. Now, as a quick preamble to this film, we have to go all the way back to the summer of 1989, when the previous Bond film, License to Kill, hit theaters. Despite the fact that it was a genuinely high-caliber Bond film, License to Kill got trashed at the box office, so much so that the franchise went into hiatus. Combine this box office failure with the fact that the Cold War ended, and the question soon became, is Bond still relevant anymore, and does he fit into today's society? The irony of this all happening again in 2020 aside, the producers realized that they had one chance to prove that Bond was still the spy that the world needed. And the producers delivered with an absolute box office smash. But does this film still hold up a quarter of a century later? Well, let's find out in taking a deep look at Pierce Brosnan's first, and in my opinion, best Bond adventure, GoldenEye. After the best gun barrel in the series thus far, and maybe the best in the series rivaling even Casino Royale's, we open to James Bond doing a bungee jump off a dam in the Soviet Union. A jump so high it was actually a world record at the time. It's one of the best stunts in the series, and I think somewhat underrated because of just the insanity of the rest of the sequence to come. After maybe the most bizarre and creepy way to introduce a new Bond in the form of him creeping up on some poor Russian in a bathroom, Bond links up with 006, aka Alec Trevelyan, played by Sean Bean in an outstanding performance, which we will get to much later. What follows is pretty much 5 minutes of great one-liners and quips, with my personal favorite being,
"Half of everything is luck, James. And the other half? Fate."
"Closing time, James! Last call!
Buy me a pint."
006 is killed, and you can't see me, but I'm doing massive air quotes as I say that, by a Soviet general, General Orimov, an incredibly underrated villain not only in this film but in the series overall. This bit about having 006 killed off is something I've always found stupid. You wouldn't hire a big-name actor like Sean Bean, then have him killed off maybe, I don't know, 5 minutes into the movie. Movies do this, where they have some big-name actor play an ostensibly small character, you know, under the brow, but it's so clear that they're going to be important later. It's like having Al Pacino play, like, a guy who runs, like, a newspaper stand or something, you know, something super unsuspecting, and then pretending he isn't going to be an integral part of the plot. I've never understood why films do it. It shows your hand really early on. Anywho, Bond, with the help of a stunt double, escapes in maybe the most badass sequence of any Bond film. The musical score here deserves particular credit. The music in this film is probably its weakest spot, but here it gives a great melding of Bond themes and Soviet music, so I tip the hat on that one. Anyways, Bond escapes on a plane, which is a funny sequence to me even today, and we're off into the theme song. The theme song is fine, with the title sequence being really the thing that steals the show, but I want to go back on the pre-title sequence just for a second. I don't want to understate this pre-title sequence. I think you can argue quite convincingly that it's the best part of any Bond film. So although it is a shame that the film technically peaks right here, I mean, holy shit, this sequence is pretty much perfect. I think it combines everything great in this film. You have great dialogue, insane action, all with really unique characters displaying some high quality acting, all in a storyline which is genuinely thrilling. These will all be themes as this film progresses. We fast forward to the mid-90s and the scene which pretty much encapsulates what everyone hates about the 90s. Shit fashion, a stupid car chase, music which is maybe worse than the slide whistle from The Man with the Golden Gun. This scene sucks and is a trash transition in energy from the pre-title sequence. Besides barely really introducing some characters, I don't know why this scene exists. Anywho, we then end up in a casino scene where Bond kicks ass at Baccarat, a game which I don't think anyone alive still knows how to play. I've tried hunting this game down in Las Vegas, like aggressively trying to find it, and I legitimately couldn't find it at any table. I'm half convinced it's not a real game. We then get one of the cleanest versions of this that you'll ever see.
"Thank you, mister."
"The name's Bond. James Bond."
It is also here that we fully get to meet Xenia Onatopp, who is effectively the henchwoman in this film and is honestly a 10 out of 10 character. Besides being just gorgeous, she is pretty much as witty as Bond is, which is awesome. She kills a man in a sex scene soon afterwards, and frankly, one has to imagine he died happy. A lot of plot happens here, most importantly being that Xenia and the General Orimov from earlier steal like a cheat code helicopter which can survive all electrical interference. How they pull this off is frankly remarkable, with Xenia using an ID of a 50-year-old overweight white man to gain entrance to the helicopter area. Her plan and the entire plot effectively this movie hinges on this, and it's crazy because it all banks on the bouncer being pretty much easy on fake IDs. It's hilarious, but whatever. The pair head to Severnaya, Russia, where they steal the GoldenEye key in just an absolute bloodbath of a scene, which is entertaining not only for the action and tension involved, but also because it is here that we get to meet Boris, a walking catchphrase machine, and Natalia, this film's Bond girl. The two are awesome characters for very different reasons, with Boris being comic relief and Natalia being a beautiful ass kicker. This sequence is maybe the coldest in the film, but is awesome on so many levels. From the fact that Xenia is clearly turned on by the whole thing, and General Orimov is not having it in the slightest, to Natalia figuring out how to escape death in remarkable fashion, this scene demonstrates so much about each of these characters while also having zero dialogue. It's good filmmaking, and I appreciate it. Anyways, General Orimov and Xenia steal the GoldenEye key, which is pretty much an electromagnetic pulse which destroys everything that I guess an electromagnetic pulse can destroy, which I assume is most things. They use it on Severnaya, which somehow Natalia survives. Like, quite frankly, the entire building explodes that she's in, and she's fine. I mean, lucky bastard. Also, these lads are just lying around to save her, which I have never understood how this happens, but okay. In the interim, we get a scene between Bond and Moneypenny, which is easily the best of the Brosnan era between the two characters. The two treat each other as equals, and although I don't think they have the same synergy as Moore's Bond and Moneypenny did, these two are excellent regardless. It is here that we also get to meet Judi Dench's M, the best in the series, I think, hands down, in honestly an impressive performance. She acts full-on as Bond's boss and doesn't take any of his shit. In fact, there's a scene where she pretty much just verbally massacres him, which is a pretty badass way to introduce this character.
You don't like me, Bond. You don't like my methods. You think I'm an accountant. A bean counter, more interested in my numbers than your instincts.
Well, gosh, yeah, I mean, as an accountant myself, I didn't know we were quite that bad, but okay, Emma. We get a brilliant Q branch scene, including the infamous exploding pen, as well as an absolutely beautiful BMW, which we really don't see again. It's such a waste. Bond is then sent to track down General Orimov, who's in St. Petersburg. This is the first time in franchise history that the series could actually film in Russia. So if you're somehow a communist and are upset that you lost the Cold War, there you go, there's your silver lining. Bond actually getting to shoot in Russia. It's here that we meet Jack Wade, CIA. I've always wondered why they didn't just decide to make this character Felix Leiter, and what I've concluded is that Jack Wade, in the Brosnan era, he's just a bitter man, and I think that having Felix act that way wouldn't work. Felix in many ways is used to set the tone in whatever movie he appears in, whether it be License to Kill, where he sets the tone of revenge, or in Casino Royale, where he pretty much convinces Bond to be a professional. I just don't think he would have fit in GoldenEye as that tone setter. Jack Wade is a bitter man, and in GoldenEye, that frankly is how Bond acts. Felix Leiter is not a bitter character in any way, so I'm actually happy that they didn't rope his character into this film and just frankly ruin him. My point being, having Jack Wade in here instead of Felix Leiter, I think makes a lot of sense, and I mention this because I've seen this debate happen a lot. What I don't support, though, is for some reason they insert a bit about how he has a tattoo on his ass which is named Muffy. It's so random, it's not really funny, so why include it? It is here, though, that we get a lot of important plot info. Jack Wade monologues about a Giannis group, which is effectively a terrorist organization that has popped up recently. In order to meet this Giannis group, Bond needs the help of the Russian mob via a guy named Zhukovsky, one of the greatest Bond allies in the entire series. I'm a big Jack Wade guy, don't get me wrong, but Zhukovsky is everything great about Jack Wade and just cranked up 100 knots. Cold as all hell, the man is all business, but shockingly charming. He's like a Dollar General store version of The Godfather, which I know is generous, but he truly is an excellent ally, not only here, but in The World's Not Enough as well. Every scene he is in makes me laugh, but, you know, unlike Boris, it isn't because Zhukovsky is goofy, but because he's almost like James Bond's alter ego as a Russian mobster. Excellent character, and hats off to whoever created him. Later that day, or maybe tomorrow. It's not really clear. It doesn't matter. Bond sets in motion a plan to meet Giannis. Effectively, the plan is for Bond to use Xenia as a middleman. It's convoluted as to why this is the plan Bond settled on, for he almost gets killed on like three separate occasions trying to do it. This lack of logic aside, the plan leads to Bond and Xenia engaging in just the best fight scene ever, which is half foreplay and half bare knuckle brawling. Bond eventually wins and has Xenia pretty much just drive him to Giannis. After the help of a little Roger Moreira judo chop to take out Xenia, Bond finally meets Giannis in a statue garden, which, if you may recall, is one of the most confusing maps in the N64 video game, so good for him for being able to actually find Giannis in that labyrinth. After an hour of screen time, we finally meet Giannis, who, fucking shocker, is Sean Bean's 006. If you didn't see this one coming, then I guess you haven't figured out how predictable the James Bond formula is at this point. It's kind of like Christoph Waltz being Blofeld and Spectre. It was just so obvious. But anyways, 006 goes on a sob story where he justifies leading a group to steal the GoldenEye key. Having this done in a statue garden of torn down Soviet figures is kind of a stroke of brilliance. James Bond is a bygone idea at that time. To steal a phrase from M earlier in the film, he's a relic of the Cold War, so pretty much having him debate Trevelyan about the ethics of what they have done and are going to do, while also being surrounded by now-defunct Cold War imagery, adds even more weight to what they're saying. Combine that with the melody music in the background, and it's one of the few times in any Bond film where we get a scene which I would characterize as touching. It's a great scene because it actually gives character to these two individuals. But man, if the next scene isn't 10 times better.
I'm here! I'm here!
Hurry! Hurry up, come on!
If I could avoid copyrights, I would just show the scene in full, but damn it, I love it. Bond and Natalia are pretty much going to be killed in the helicopter from earlier. After barely escaping, they are picked up by Russian authorities. Natalia gives her own sob story, which is a mirror of the scene we just saw with 006. Pretty much, this scene serves to update the two of them on the information that we as an audience already know, which is tacky, but it's done pretty seamlessly. We then get a wild sequence in a pseudo-prison area where Bond and Natalia are grilled by the Russian Defense Secretary himself, which, saying out loud, is fucking crazy. Imagine if the Secretary of Defense for the US just went to a prison and just started grilling random people at gunpoint. Stupid, yes, but in 2020, I'm willing to roll with anything, so let's just go with it. Natalia then delivers the best quote of the film.
Still death, and what's the penalty for treason?
Oh, stop it, both of you! Stop it! You're like boys with toys.
And then informs the defense secretary that General Orimov is responsible for taking the GoldenEye key. Orimov then rolls in just absolutely hammered and starts shooting up the room before framing Bond for the secretary's death, which leads to a shootout for the ages. If you've ever played the Archives level in the video game, that's what happens here. This scene is badass not only for the shooting, not only for how it escalates the plot and character development so seamlessly, but it's all done with a brilliant piece of score, which, again, I want to tip the hat to. Natalia is kidnapped by Orimov during this, and it can only be blamed on sheer stupidity alone. Bond escapes through a badass bit where he swings out a window into, I guess, a parking lot for tanks when we get this. Bond chases after Natalia and Orimov in a tank down the streets of St. Petersburg, which is equal parts badass and hilarious. Can you imagine being Orimov, just absolutely shit drunk, and you're getting chased by an actual tank? It's such a needless detail making him hammered to include it, but for some reason I just think it's really funny. Like, he's just ramming people on the street. Like, why is him being a drunkard a part of his character at all? Whatever. The scene as a whole is excellently choreographed, and in a film that pretty much never uses the Bond theme song, the part that they do here is, it's pretty good. The gang then rendezvous at what can only be described as a unit of a train, with Xenia, 006, Orimov, and Natalia all on board. After Bond quite literally explodes the train with his tank, a sentence I cannot believe I have to utter, we get a great sequence of dialogue.
Why can't you just be a good boy and die?
You first. You second.
When Bond jumps on board the train. It is here when Bond is given a moral dilemma. He either has to kill 006 to end the mission or Orimov to save Natalia. Bond, of course, is a horny bastard, so he kills Orimov and 006 escapes. I do remember once playing the video game and I was able to kill both of them, and even though that was probably a glitch, all I'm saying is that, you know, this isn't as hopeless a trolley problem as Bond makes it out to be. Maybe Bond should just be better at shooting a gun. He could have ended the movie right here. Natalia and Bond are trapped on the train, with Bond figuring out how to escape while Natalia hacks Boris to figure out where 006 is going. It's a hilarious scene because ostensibly it's supposed to be both of them at their best, you know, Bond as a spy knowing how to escape and Natalia being some genius computer programmer. However, Natalia has to figure out Boris' password in order to hack him, which is a five-letter word for something you can sit on but can't take with you. That's the clue. Now, a five-letter word for something you sit on is obviously chair, but she spends a solid 30 seconds failing at figuring this out before Bond has to help. It comes off like a child doing, you know, like a kid's crossword and just failing so miserably that the parent has to just do it for them. Natalia is supposed to be a really smart Bond girl, like a Bond equal, and she has moments of brilliance, such as when she survives being shot by Xenia earlier in the film. However, this combined with how she got kidnapped by Orimov in the first place, and I just don't understand why the writers made her have so many gaffes, for it diminishes her character significantly. It turns her into a klutz, which is not who she should be in this film as a character. Anyway, they escape, and Bond immediately starts flirting with her. It's actually impressive how quick he steps up into the batting cage throughout this film. The duo then heads to Cuba, for that is where Natalia tracks Boris and 006 to. We get a weird romance scene, which feels kind of like a man's final dinner before going into battle, you know, that sort of vibe that you always see in all those war films. I don't know, it was just sort of a switch in tone. I completely respect that they're trying to add the personal element to 007 versus 006, which is the crux of the final act of this film, but this scene has always felt a little heavy-handed for me. This time around, I actually enjoyed it more than I normally do, because I think Natalia sells it well, but the, you know, overswelling romantic element to the musical score just tips this part of the film too much into tacky territory. Yet again, this is a great example of the score just fucking up a part of the film. We then proceed into the final act, which is where Bond and Natalia hunt down 006 and the gang. After, through sheer luck, finding them, we get a showdown between Bond and Xenia. For a fight that lasts maybe 15 seconds, it's ridiculously violent and sexual, which, you know, gets two thumbs up from this reviewer. We also get probably the best pun of the film here.
She always did enjoy a good squeeze.
It is here that 006's lair is unveiled in the form of a satellite that is so big that the fact that the US government couldn't find it, it's kind of sad as an American, honestly. It's funny because we also get to see inside of the lair, which is like four stories high and is staffed by people you would find in like the front office of a dentist. Not your average pyromaniac super criminal in my opinion, but what do I know, in the words of M from earlier, accounts are only good for counting beans, I guess. Yes, I'm still upset. Anyways, getting back on track, we learn that 006's goal is to rob London and then use the GoldenEye key to erase any trace of him doing so. The actual master plot, honestly, doesn't really matter, so I'm not going to talk about it any more than that. Meanwhile, back in the WeWork building, Natalia runs off to hack Boris and the GoldenEye key from going off, while an absolutely wonderful interaction between Bond and 006 occurs. Pretty much, 006 and 007 throw just verbal haymakers at each other while really demonstrating just how both of them are pieces of shit. While this goes on, Boris and Natalia have their own little scuffle when Natalia won't just assist Boris in unhacking her original hacking of him. It doesn't matter, but the entire scene is tense as all hell as we watch Boris click away at the exploding pen from earlier. I've seen this film maybe two dozen times, and for the life of me, I can't keep track of the clicks as it happens. However, I guessed he clicked it three times at some point, setting off the exploding pen, and the entire place just goes to hell as Natalia and Bond escape to the satellite itself to destroy it once and for all. What then follows is a 10-minute straight just battle royale between 006 and 007 on one hand, and Boris and a computer, frankly, on the other. In terms of the climax of a Bond film, it's really good, because Bond and the Bond girl both have their own storylines at stake. this is a common theme in every single one of the Brosnan films, which is if either Bond or the Bond girl fails, then they're both kind of fucked. I think Die Another Day is a great example of this separate storyline happening and it just failing miserably. But in this one, I think it was extremely effective. I don't want to undersell it, though. The fight between 006 and 007 is intense, like really intense. No music plays. The two just kick the absolute shit out of each other. And there's an added emotional aspect to it, not only because they were friends, but because we never really get to see two 00s go at it, especially because one would assume that 006 would be better than a 007. This scene has all the makings for a great fight, and I think it really delivers. It's the best fight scene in the Brosnan era, in my opinion, and one of the best in the series. After the two just rock each other, Bond and 006 duke it out on a platform before Bond outmaneuvers 006 in what frankly was a cheap shot before we get this badass line.
For England, James?
No. For me.
Now, we can all debate whether or not this is too dark for Bond, but I think it's pretty sick. End of story. 006 somehow survives the fall. Like, what? Bond escapes by doing the riskiest thing of any character in this film by jumping onto a helicopter. I've had to do those, you know, BS leadership camps where you have to trust yourself to make the leap. And in effect, we had to do something almost identical to this jump. Maybe it's because, again, we're all accountants attempting this jump, but I think only like three of us could make this helicopter grab. I mean, it's not a layup. Hence why the romance music playing in the background while this is going on is so inappropriate. It's an intense scene, and the music should match it, doesn't at all. Anyways, the satellite collapses on 006, and Boris is killed in the funniest way possible, as Bond and Natalia make out in the grass nearby. The film effectively ends in the same way as Goldfinger does, with a pan into the sky, and that, my friends, is GoldenEye.
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Longtime viewers of this channel know that I'm a huge GoldenEye fan. Indeed, it's one of my favorite films of all time. I'll concede that part of that is due to nostalgia. However, this film has all the makings of a great Bond film, and I think its errors are truly limited. Overall, it's an outstanding movie. I want to start by discussing the villains. 006 is very similar to Silva in Skyfall. However, in every way that Silva is bitter at the UK, and Bond is just sort of a blunt instrument to stop him, in GoldenEye, that battle between 006 and 007 feels much more intimate, and one could tip the cap at pretty much anyone here. The writing is clever in that it establishes early and often that 006 and 007 are friends without being overbearing with it. However, I think Sean Bean is really what sells it. The way he even looks at 007 changes as the film goes on. In the beginning of the film, it feels like almost like a younger brother looking up to the sibling he admires. Near the end, his eyes just have rage in them. And that isn't the script, that's just Sean Bean embracing the role. Although I don't think his master plan is really all that unique or interesting, I think the character himself is, which is why he is in an elite tier in terms of his ranking as a Bond villain in this series. What is particularly interesting in terms of villains is Orlov. The guy is kind of an idiot, so the fact that he reached general in the Soviet Union and Russia is frankly impressive, but that little note aside, his character is criminally underrated. One would be hard-pressed to find General Orlov on any rankings list for top Bond villains. This is definitely in part because he is in 006's shadow, but I think it's also because he's just kind of overlooked at times. His character's wild. I mean, he's a drunken hothead who follows no rules. He's incredibly egotistical and impulsive, and yet in several scenes, it is clearly demonstrated that the man is full of emotion. One of the biggest issues with early day Bond films is that the characters are bland outside of the fact that they're just evil. General Orlov has layers to him, and frankly, could have carried his own film if he wanted to. So the fact that he gets paired with 006 and Xenia, and I guess Boris, makes for a real just all-star cast of villains. Speaking of which, I mean, wow, Xenia is a great character. She isn't actually in the movie that long, and every scene she is in is brief at best, but she's clearly a Bond equal, and having her complete the trio or quartet, if you're counting Boris, of evil with 006 and Orlov leads to, in my opinion, the best overall group of villains in the series. Although an argument could be made for Goldfinger on that front. I think Xenia tips it to GoldenEye overall as a villain cast. I know throughout this review, Boris hasn't come up a ton, and that really was on purpose. I have always enjoyed Boris, and I think that his character is actually used very well in terms of keeping what is a pretty dark film relatively light, while also himself driving the plot than most of the characters. However, I think people just overhype him to be like a god among men in terms of characters. He's funny, yes. He's multidimensional, sure. But I think his character is given a little too much love. I mean, for God's sakes, he's in the film for like 10 minutes tops. I think lesser characters like Zhukovsky, you know, the Russian mobster, they add more to the mix than Boris does, to be frank. On the other hand, though, Natalia, I think, is still underappreciated. I mean, she's gorgeous, she's very clever, and she frankly holds her own. I think the video game does her dirty in the fact that she's just turned into the most hateable dope of all time, but in the film, she crushed it. I will never understand why the film felt the need to make her so clumsy at times. Not being able to solve the chair riddle, literally falling into Orimov's arms as she tries to escape him in the archive scene, it just doesn't make sense to me. Why would you go out of your way to make a strong female character and then simultaneously water her down with these bonehead moments? In a way, it could be to show that 007 is still in charge, but that's so obvious, frankly, because, you know, the movie's about him, that you don't need to dumb down her character to do that. On a completely other front, you know, Isabella Skoripko, which I just botched, but the person who plays Natalia, her daughter and a good buddy of mine are co-workers, and apparently Isabella is very nice, so I'm happy to hear that. Now for the 800-pound gorilla in the room, Pierce Brosnan is Bond. I think he crushed it. He looks the part. He's charming as all hell. He does the fight scenes very well. He's smooth, he's clever, and he can also be very cold, which is something that kind of happens in all of his Bond films. He's truly the whole package as a Bond actor. Connery, for obvious reasons, will always go down as the GOAT, but I think Brosnan is right up there for the best Bond actor, and he's always been my personal favorite. The scripts he's given were continually bad, with the exception of GoldenEye, so I'm happy that in his one quality script, he just knocks it out of the park. I can't really think of any issues in his performance, which is not the case really for most other Bond actors. Although I think the quality of the Brosnan era just collapses spectacularly as soon as this film is over, here he does really well. And I think a lot of what this comes back to is the script. I mean, this is the first time in franchise history that we have an original script. Up to License to Kill, all of them are based off the books. This film in many ways was unprecedented because they just kind of had to go for it. Overall, I don't have any major issues with the plot. I think some things were illogical, like Bond's plan to meet Giannis just didn't make sense. I thought some scenes were unnecessary, particularly the chase scene in the cars at the beginning of the movie. And there were some minor bits that were just bizarre, like the Muffy tattoo on Jack Wade. But in everything I just listed, these were not flaws with the script per se. Rather, they're sort of matters of taste. In terms of like actual storyline, it's pretty airtight, honestly. And I'm not saying this is like Shawshank Redemption level quality, but for an action movie, it's pretty well paced and builds on itself quite nicely. Overall though, GoldenEye really crushed it across the board. There were slight logical issues with it, but every Bond film has those, it just kind of comes to the territory. And this isn't even to mention the fact that if you play the video game, you're gonna have the nostalgia factor when you watch this film. But taking that aside, I cannot recommend this film enough. It's one of the best in the series, and frankly, it kind of saved the series in the 90s, so we should all be thankful for it. I really would give this a film a 10 out of 10. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. So with GoldenEye in the books, demonstrating that Bond can work in a post-Cold War environment, the producers were at a crossroads. Should we build on the success of GoldenEye and continue Connery-esque Bond films, or do we revive more era camp? Well, we will find out what their decision was next time in one of the most ridiculous Bond films to ever exist, 1997's Tomorrow Never Dies. So what do you guys think of GoldenEye? Do you think it's overrated, underrated? Do you think people enjoy it just because they have nostalgia for the video game? Whatever it may be, leave it in the comments section below. And remember, like, share, comment, subscribe, and I'll see you guys next time. Ciao.